what changed, whether it was supply or demand in shipping more of the MI300 family?
Well, good morning, Ed. It's great to be here with you today. Look, we had a very strong second quarter. We're very pleased with the overall growth that we saw, really led by the data center business. So our data center business more than doubled year on year in the second quarter. And we see, you know, a strong second half there as well as strength in PCs. So, you know, to your question about, you know, MI300 and what are we seeing in AI, you know, we're seeing an environment where everybody needs more data center AI infrastructure. You know, computing is really the foundation of what drives, you know, sort of all of these AI capabilities going forward. You know, MI300 has been well into the qualifications at numerous of our top customers. And, you know, what we saw over the past quarters, we passed some very significant milestones in both one, you know, ramping up our supply chain, but also passing important, you know, data center customer milestones where customers have moved our product into production. So it's an exciting time right now. You know, we did update our full year AI guidance from greater than $4 billion a quarter ago to greater than $4.5 billion. I think we're seeing great traction in our hardware and you know, software milestones. So overall, I'm feeling really good about the setup going into the second half of the year.
Lisa, I'm really interested in kind of the design and performance differences for all the AI accelerators that are out there. You and I have talked about the technology differences, but on the call, you gave the example of Microsoft and its use in the quarter of the MI300 generation. When you're speaking to a hyperscaler, when might they opt for using MI300 over NVIDIA's H100 and, I suppose, to a lesser extent, Gaudi? What is the specification or performance driver that would make it a better solution in a certain use case?
Yeah, well, first of all, you know, I'd like to, you know, say that Microsoft is a phenomenal partner. They're a great partner for us, you know, across, you know, the data center as well as, you know, the client businesses. And when you see, in particular, you know, how complex these AI systems are, you know, you want to have, you know, the best technology capability. You know, I can go into speeds and feeds, but I won't. I think it's suffice it to say, you need this type of computing for both training and inference. In our case, you know, MI300 is the leading inference accelerator today. We have the highest memory, you know, bandwidth, and that's really helpful. You know, when you're asking questions to, you know, something like, you know, a ChatGPT or a Llama model, and you want your answers to return faster, you want the fastest inference accelerator out there. And, you know, MI300 does very, very well in that framework. And then when you take a step back and just look at the overall AI market, I mean, the overall AI market is growing so fast. There is no one solution fits all. Actually, you know, you do have, you know, different workloads will be optimized with different hardware. So I think we have a tremendous opportunity. I think we're very excited about the overall market growth. And then as more customers get a chance to use our AMD Instinct roadmap, I think we're getting very positive feedback.
Lisa, you addressed head on the call, I think, that the investment cycle for AI has legs. It will continue. But just interested in what you just said, can you kind of apportion of how much of that spend or investment is going to training versus inference at this stage?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we look at this cycle, Ed, you know, you and I have talked about this before. I mean, we're forecasting that the overall market for AI accelerators, when you look out in, let's call it 27, 28 and beyond timeframe, you know, will, you know, be, you know, $400 billion plus, which is, you know, huge market overall. I think in that you're going to need a lot of training and you're going to need a lot of inference. You know, today I would say that, you know, most people would say that you're building foundation with training. So training is a place where, you know, you want the largest models to really be capable of, you know, of, you know, using all of the large data infrastructure. But going forward, you would expect that, you know, inference demand will actually surpass training. Most people believe that. And, you know, I think this isn't, you know, we'll see how this plays out over the next couple of years. But you're going to need technology for both training and inference. And at the end of the day, you're also going to have a very diverse set of models and a very diverse set of needs. So you have the largest foundational models out there, but then you also have, you know, many enterprises are training on their own data, and they'll use, you know, sort of a different type of infrastructure for that.
Lisa, what's actually being done to address the supply constraints such as they are that, that impact your abilities with MI300?
Well, you know, I would say overall, when you look at the semiconductor supply chain, it's been amazing. I mean, we have substantially increased the overall capacity as an industry to address this very high AI demand. We've also addressed, from an AMD standpoint, our supply chain has been expanding every quarter. You know, we announced in the second quarter that we did over $1 billion of revenue in AI accelerators, which is a fantastic number. We see that increasing every quarter as we go into the second half of the year. The supply chain will continue to be tight as we go into 2025, and that just says a bit about just how much demand there is out there. We have great partnerships with our supply chain partners, and we're working on expanding that as fast as possible.
Lisa, the dominant player in the market for AI accelerators that go into data centers is committed to this cadence of essentially a new generation of chip annually. What does AMD do to compete with that and develop new products going forward?
Well, Ed, what we see in the market, you know, spending time with, the industry leaders, is this market is moving so fast that you have to be on an annual cadence. So we announced last month that we have accelerated and expanded our roadmap. You'll see us later this year. We're going to launch our MI325 series, which is the next step in our roadmap. Next year, in 2025, we'll launch our MI350 series, which is a brand new architecture. And we're already well on our way to our MI400 series, which will launch in 2026. So we are on an annual cadence. Not only that, it's not just about the accelerator. CPUs continue to be very, very important. We see that overall. Networking continues to be very important. Overall, system capability is also very important. And we are investing in bringing all of those capabilities together to really help our customers with the best infrastructure for their AI workloads.
Lisa, what I love about the Bloomberg Technology audience is there's going to be a big body of people out there who think AMD and they think PC and gaming. You know, that's kind of the reality of it. You painted this kind of positive picture for PC, at least for your company, in the second half of the year. Is that a story of a market recovery and broadly the market doing well? Or is AMD doing something specific to outperform in that environment?
Yeah, we see a couple of things, Ed. First of all, the PC market is a good market. You know, the second half of the year is typically stronger than the first half anyways from a market standpoint. We see some positive signs in the market. I will say I'm very excited about AI PCs. I view AI PCs as an inflection point for what PCs can do in all of our daily lives, whether you're talking about a corporate environment or a consumer home environment. So that's a positive. I think we are also just launching a whole new generation of chips. You know, we call it our Zen 5 family, both notebooks and desktops. They are fantastic. We're really happy with the reception for those. And so we see that as an opportunity that is, our product roadmap launching usually gives us a lift into the second half of the year. And then, in the medium term, going into 2025, you're going to see a lot more AI PCs. You're also going to see, we believe, an enterprise refresh cycle. So I think there are positive indicators for the PC market, going forward.
Would you be able to give me some sort of forward-looking commentary on the gaming business in particular, when that might see some improvement?
Yeah, I mean, let me talk a little bit about gaming, Ed. First of all, the gaming segment is a great segment. We truly, value the strong partnerships we have with the market leaders like Microsoft and Sony in the console cycle. Now, typically, these console cycles, do have an ebb and a flow. And so we're in the second half of the console cycle. Let's call it the fifth year. And so we have seen a decline in revenue. I think that was very much as expected. We would expect that, it would take until the next refresh cycle for you to see a substantial change in that. But this is very much a market that we know, we love, and we believe has great long-term alignment with our roadmap and our IP.
Lisa, I acknowledge you've kind of had a very busy 2024. You spent a lot of time on airplanes. I think about Computex in particular. while there, you were on stage with a number of partners, and we talked just now about the sort of legacy gaming and PC business. I just wondered if you have any sort of evidence or data you can give me that those partners are putting AMD into sales channels where you might not have any experience. For example, like in the public sector or selling your technology to governments rather than just the hyperscalers.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great question. First of all, you know, we love our partnerships, Ed. I think partnerships are, you know, what makes this industry truly special, right? Every company has their secret sauce, their great product, but when you put it together and really bring the best of, you know, the industry together is when you get the, you know, the great payoff. When you look at our business, first of all, you know, let me talk a little bit about our, you know, enterprise server business. I'm super pleased to see the progress that we're making there. When you think about, you know, the server CPU market, let's call it, you know, outside of AI, there's a whole set of workloads that need the best, you know, general purpose computing. That's what we have with our, you know, fourth generation EPYC, and we just launched our fifth generation, you know, EPYC, or previewed our fifth generation EPYC as well. Very, very important, you know, foundation for, you know, these enterprise data centers. We made substantial progress here in the first half of the year. I would say one third of our new design wins are actually from customers that have never used AMD before. So that's exactly what you said is, you know, as we introduce AMD more to the broader enterprise, you know, customers, yes. We're seeing great traction, primarily because we have, you know, the best performance per dollar and the best performance per watt, you know, out there. So we do see a tremendous opportunity in the enterprise market, both on the traditional compute side, as well as AI, as well as AI PCs. So all of those are great opportunities.
Great. Lisa, I know you've got to go to your next meeting. So very quickly, what's the talent story for AMD and getting the best people?
We are very, very happy with the talent story. I mean, we have a tremendous you know, engineering team. They're doing great things on hardware and software. And we just announced our intent to acquire a fantastic AI company, Silo AI, that's based in Europe, that is also, you know, adds great talent to the company. So this is a war for talent, and I would say we're very happy with you know, the great engineering capabilities that we have to move the roadmap forward.